okay, let's start, and you will get what you wanted, but I warn you, it will be more boring, systematic, repetitive, and so on. And I tried to be honest, so although I promised to the poet to come yesterday evening, I didn't come, but sincerely, because I struggled with this, how to start with Hegel, and it's a problem. So please, maybe we'll be a little bit bored. All I can say is that I will try to proceed slowly, systematically, not any kind of general introduction, just to give you an idea of some fundamental Hegelian moves. Because the first thing to do, of course, is if your knowledge of Hegel is the general one that you get from textbooks, you know, German idealist, absolute idealism, he believed in a kind of a pan-logical view that you can, out of the self-movement of a notion, you can somehow develop, deduce the entire reality in the sense of absolute knowing, the end of history, all that stuff. Forget about this. Or if you have an idea that somehow the basic, as it were, matrix of the Hegelian movement, of the self-deployment of Hegelian dialectic, is this infamous triad, thesis, antithesis, synthesis. Forget about it. Incidentally, I hope you know that the ABC, Hegel even never used the terms. It's quite breathtaking how people don't take into account this. Hegel never used the term. I'm not sure that it's Karl Rosenkranz, one of the pupils of Hegel, who putatively once uses these terms. So it's quite breathtaking when you take these extremely anti-Hegelian histories of philosophy, like the popular one by Bertrand Russell, where he automatically assumed thesis, antithesis, synthesis. You find nowhere this, simply nowhere this in Hegel. Also, the idea that Hegel somehow thought that history is over with him, that he comes at the end. How should I put it naively? It's empirically not true. For example, if you read closely his philosophy of nature, again and again he emphasizes it is too early to say, we don't know yet enough about that, and so on. Even in the domain of history, for example, it's very interesting to read the most racist Hegel, although I claim it's much more ambiguous, the introduction to his philosophy of history, where he deals with so-called geographic presuppositions of history. Okay, here you have Hegel, I admit it, at his worst Eurocentric, because he deals with black Africans only here as not history proper, but geographic presuppositions of history. That's another story. But nonetheless, what is interesting here is that, for example, when he, and remind you, this was written in 1810, when he mentions briefly Russia, Russian Empire, and United States. He says it's too early today, next 20th century will be the century of these two countries. We cannot develop theory now. So, at least empirically, he wasn't an idiot. No. When he made predictions, they were usually good predictions. No. Incidentally, although Marxists are usually dismissed as a kind of, you know, fanatical dogmatics, sometimes they were incredibly, okay, I wouldn't say intelligent, maybe just lucky. For example, as far as I know, I read this in an article of a, how do you call it, futurologue, guys who deal with future in a scientific way, more or less, if you can. He confesses that the only guy who already in the 19th century clearly predicted World War II, not one, was Engels, Friedrich Engels. In a letter already in, I think, late 1870s or early 1880s, when it became clear this tension because of German role, wanted more colonies and so on, and then he said, not only will probably there be somewhere in the beginning of next century a big European war, but probably Germany will find itself going between two poles, Anglo-Saxon, French, and Russian. It will lose the war, and then a decade or two later, it will start a new war. No, that's not so bad. No. Okay, but let's go on. Please have patience today. You can complain afterwards, and we can move back to obscene stories about cinemas and what other obscenities I like to talk about, structure of toilets or whatever. No, okay. Incidentally, I can be, just to start with an amusement, I don't know if you know the story, I can really be vulgar here. Once, even my Swiss guests didn't know here, because once I debated here with some Swiss guys about, I warn you, this is politically incorrect, you can probably, no, but you cannot, I will, okay. Like, you know, in Europe, we have each nation, not every, but most of them are identified with a certain sexual practice. So, to be vulgar, if you say to your girlfriend, let's do it the Spanish way, it means penis between the breasts. If you say, let's do it, you didn't know this.
I didn't know that.
And you are Spanish, or what? Traitor to your country, betraying patriotism. And at least...
You know, that's what we call the French way.
Really? Ah, but it's always, these paradoxes are, I know, this is always like this, that's godless, because for example, this wonderful paradox that in my country and in Balkan, we call this mixed vegetable salad, salad, French salad. In France they call it salad macédoine. You know, or for example, what always intrigued me is, you know, the whipped cream. In France, they call it Chantilly. Chantilly is a city there, you know. Okay, my point, you know, is this Bertrand Russell problem. Does the barber shave? How do they call it in Chantilly itself, you know? So, okay, my point is that, okay, so that's how, then, I don't know, now you can again protest, but at least in my country and in Germany, I know. If you say to a girlfriend, let's do it Italian way, it means anal penetration. Now, again, am I wrong?
In our country, that means
Greek.
Greek. Oh, we have other prejudices. Sorry for you about Greece. For us, the main idea is that Greek guys are mostly gay. Okay, but that's typical Slavic anti-Greek prejudice. This is all dirty.
What's
no?
The Slovenian way?
Sorry?
What's the Slovenian way?
Impotent. You do it half. You do it half in asleep, and then basically you just touch the girl in half dream, and then after she awakens in the morning, you try to convince her that something happened, counting on the fact that her memory is not good and so on. No, but what I'm saying is that then, of course, I was talking with, here in Switzerland, in Zurich, with some Swiss students and professors, we entered the topic of what would be the Swiss way. Okay, the first idea was the cynical one. If you are a man, of course, you don't even need a body, a woman, you just masturbate with money or whatever. No, no, but then I came... A very creative idea, no? Which was that, what about, you know what is Swiss Army knife?
Yes.
This, you know, 10 of them. No, can you imagine Swiss Army wife, you know, like, you know, masturbating with one with all the legs? Maybe this would be the Swiss way, no? And, this is for me, you see, real tolerant multiculturalism, where you're really open to the other country. Okay, but... Okay, we have to do. Let's start. First, Hegel and history. You know what is the standard problem with Hegel? Probably you know this about Hegel, and this is even usually... I warn you, I will consciously move at a very elementary level. If you... Hegel is usually perceived as the one who asserted a kind of a universal historicist dialectical movement, nothing is stable, everything is moving, changing, there is movement, not only